blood collection tubes. Hi there. Welcome to another Chalk Talk episode where we'll be introducing the six most commonly used blood collection tubes. These tubes are the serum tube, coagulation tube, erythrocyte sedimentation rate tube, heparin tube, EDTA tube, and sodium fluoride tube. You've probably noticed that we've shown two tubes for each type. This is because the tube caps have a distinct color coding system, either in accordance with international or in accordance with European standards. To clearly distinguish the difference between the tube caps of both standards, we'll be using vacutainers colored according to international standards and monovet tubes colored according to European standards. But don't be misled. The color of the tube cap isn't determined by its shape, but by its content. Let's take a closer look. EDTA tubes have a lavender cap in accordance with the international standard and a red cap in accordance with the European standard. They are usually used to measure blood counts. To determine the different numbers of cells in the sample, coagulation in the blood sample should be completely inhibited. Therefore, the collection tube contains EDTA. The underlying principle is actually quite simple. Calcium, also termed factor 4, is important in blood coagulation. When calcium is removed, blood doesn't clot. So let's look into this in more detail. Calcium mediates the binding of coagulation factors to negatively charged surfaces such as the cell surface, thereby facilitating blood clotting. You can find out more in part 3 of our series of Chalk Talk episodes on secondary hemostasis. Let's take a look at what EDTA does. To ensure that there's no calcium in the blood sample, a molecule that has a high binding affinity to calcium is required, EDTA. The EDTA molecule and calcium form a complex, which results in calcium unable to initiate coagulation. EDTA can bind to a maximum of 6 atoms. However, it also forms stable complexes with fewer ions. One molecule of EDTA can therefore bind to several calcium ions in blood, resulting in an undefined ratio of both substances. As a result, the inhibition of coagulation with EDTA is considered irreversible, as it remains unknown how much calcium would be needed to restore original conditions in the collection tube. Blood cells usually preserve their morphology in the presence of EDTA. Therefore, EDTA blood is mainly used to analyze blood cells. The most commonly performed hematology tests on EDTA blood include the complete blood count, differential blood count, as well as blood group typing. A larger collection tube is usually used for immunohematology tests. EDTA blood is also suitable for determining hemoglobin A1c, several genetic tests, for example, single-point mutations such as factor V Leiden, and pathogen detection, for example, HIV via polymerase chain reaction, in short, PCR. However, there are tests for which EDTA blood is not suitable because EDTA can bind to any divalent ion. Therefore, calcium or magnesium levels can't be determined in EDTA blood. In addition, the activity of enzymes whose spatial structure is stabilized by such ions also can't be analyzed. To determine the level of these ions and enzymes, blood should be collected in a serum tube. A serum collection tube is used if serum is desired for analysis, which is obtained after the blood is allowed to clot. Clinical chemistry analysis of electrolytes, such as calcium, and various liver function tests are usually performed in serum. Serum tubes are also used in serology, especially for the diagnosis and monitoring of rheumatic, immunologic, and infectious diseases. To promote blood clotting, silica particles are present in the tubes, acting as a clot activator. You may have heard of glass initiating blood clotting. This is due to silica, a major constituent of glass. Silica has numerous negative charges on its surface, which help activate factor 12, also known as Hageman factor. Factor 12 initiates the intrinsic pathway of coagulation. Nowadays, blood collection tubes are made of plastic, and to compensate for this, they are either coated with silica or contain silica-coated beads. Serum tubes are characterized by a red cap according to the international standard and a white cap according to the European standard. These tubes don't contain a serum gel separator. However, there are also tubes that contain a serum gel separator. These have a yellow cap according to the international standard and a brown cap according to the European standard. The separation gel acts as a diffusion barrier because it has a specific density between that of serum and coagulated blood. During centrifugation, the gel forms a stable barrier between these two layers. This barrier significantly reduces serum contamination by cell components and increases serum yield. However, if a variety of laboratory parameters are to be measured, several tubes should be collected. One advantage of serum samples is that they can be frozen and stored for future use. To analyze coagulation parameters in blood, a sample is required in which coagulation is not irreversibly inhibited, as accomplished in the EDTA tube, but the blood sample must be reversibly stopped from further clotting before measurement. This is achieved using coagulation tubes, which contain sodium citrate. Therefore, they're also often referred to as citrate tubes. Coagulation tubes have a light blue cap in accordance with the international standard and a green cap in accordance with the European standard. Temporary anticoagulation in the coagulation tube functions similar to that in the EDTA tube. The only difference is that calcium is removed using citrate, which binds less strongly than EDTA. The calcium citrate salt formed in blood in the collection tube, following the addition of citrate, has a clearly defined stoichiometry. Two citrate ions are able to remove three calcium ions. This enables the required amount of calcium to be added to the blood sample to restore original conditions in the collection tube. Subsequently, coagulation parameters such as prothrombin time, or PT, and activated partial thromboplastin time, in short, APTT, can be analyzed. But take care. To avoid false measurements, correct ratios are required. The collection tube must be completely filled with blood and not contain any additional air from the collection system. The heparin tube has a green cap in accordance with the international standard and an orange cap in accordance with the European standard. It contains heparin. Heparin is a polysaccharide that acts as an anticoagulant and forms a complex with antithrombin 3. Antithrombin 3 inhibits blood clotting by binding to the activated forms of factors 10 and 2. However, as a complex, antithrombin 3 and heparin inactivate factors 10 and 2 more rapidly. Heparin tubes are used, for example, to measure the immune function of white blood cells or to perform chromosome analysis. So, what is the difference between a heparin tube and an EDTA tube if both tubes inhibit the coagulation process? Both tubes initially appear quite similar. In fact, many clinical chemistry tests that can be analyzed in EDTA tubes can also be analyzed in heparin tubes. However, EDTA tubes have an advantage. EDTA also inhibits calcium-dependent enzymes, resulting in a more stable sample. Therefore, sensitive parameters can be detected over a longer period of time. Consequently, EDTA tubes have become a standard in the measurement of numerous laboratory parameters. Yet, EDTA tubes also have a disadvantage. EDTA affects cell function and is therefore unsuitable for functional analysis. For this reason, heparin tubes are the preferred choice in analyzing cell function. The sodium fluoride tube has a gray cap in accordance with the international standard and a yellow cap in accordance with the European standard. It's used to determine glucose or lactate levels in blood. To accurately measure blood glucose levels, glycolysis in red blood cells must be inhibited. Otherwise, measured glucose levels will be too low and lactate levels too high. To prevent this, fluoride ions are used to inhibit important enzymes involved in energy metabolism. In addition to sodium fluoride, other agents are sometimes added to stop metabolic processes. These include calcium binders such as citrate, oxalate, or EDTA, which are often added to the sodium fluoride tubes. Analysis of the erythrocyte sedimentation rate, in short, ESR, can provide initial evidence of the presence of an inflammatory process. The collected blood is stored at room temperature for a certain period of time. During this time, a sediment of blood cells is formed. This occurs rapidly if acute phase proteins are increased in blood in response to inflammation. One of the reasons is that acute phase proteins decrease the surface charge of red blood cells. As a result, the red blood cells do not repel each other and therefore form large aggregates, sinking to the bottom of the tube. Because the ESR not only depends on serum protein composition but also other parameters, results are only of significance if rates greatly differ from the normal reference values. ESR measurement can only be performed in anticoagulated blood. Therefore, the anticoagulant citrate is also used in ESR tubes. The distance in millimeters at which red blood cells fall after an hour is read using a special scale. Although the ESR tube is easily recognizable by its narrower diameter, it can also be identified by the distinct color of its cap. ESR tubes have a black cap in accordance with the international standard and a purple cap in accordance with the European standard.